We're finished with the book of Mark, but I had a couple of little housekeeping things I wanted to do right here at the end of the book, and one of them is in verse number 19, when it says, "So then after the Lord had spoken unto them, he was received up into heaven and sat on the right hand of God." Now that issue of him sitting on the right hand of God is something that is repeated over and over, Peter in Acts chapter 2 quotes the Psalm 110 about that, about why he sat at the right hand of God. The book of Hebrews numerous times quotes the verse in Psalm 110. If you look with me at Luke chapter 22, Jesus had, the night he was being interrogated by the Pharisees and the religious leaders of Israel, he made a statement to them about this. And what he's doing is exactly what prophecy called for him to do. In Luke 22, verse number 66, now he's in front of the Sanhedrin, the religious council of Israel. And as Luke 22, 66, "And as soon as it was day, the elders of the people and the chief priests and scribes came together and led him," that is Christ, "into their council, saying, Art thou the Christ? Tell us." They've been interrogating him. They've been making accusations. They've had false witnesses come, all this kind of stuff. And tell us. And he never would tell them. they were trying to condemn him. They weren't really interested. But watch what he says. "If I tell you, you will not believe. And if I also ask you, you shall not answer me, nor let me go. Never hereafter shall the Son of Man sit on the right hand of the power of God." Now that's in essence quoting Psalm 110 verse 1, saying, "I'm the one Psalm 110 verse 1 is talking about." They got the message. Then said they all, "Art thou then the Son of God?" And he said unto them, "You say that I am." And they said, "What need we any further witness? For we ourselves have heard of his own mouth." So they they were interested in doing is condemning him. But when he says to them, "Hereafter shall the Son of Man sit on the right hand of God," right hand of the power of God. That's when you sit on the right hand of someone. That's the power position. And what he's saying is, "I am the Messiah. I am the one those verses talk about." He doesn't say, "I'm his." He said, "I'm the one the verses talk about. If you believe the verses, you'd believe me." So it's an important statement when Mark says this. He's saying, he's gone up, ascended into heaven, and he's sitting at the right hand of the majesty of God on high. He is the Messiah. And that's the whole issue. And that's where authority comes from, is from the right hand of God. Come with me, if you will, to the book of Hebrews. And actually, stop in Acts 2 as we go there. Acts chapter 2. And you know, Peter's preaching to Israel on the day of Pentecost. He's told them, "You've crucified the Messiah. You mistook him. God demonstrated to you who he was, and you with wicked hands have crucified him, but God's raised him up. So you're in trouble. You killed him wrongly. God's raised him up, and now he's going to send him back to be the judge." Verse 34, Luke 2:34. I'm sorry, Acts 2:34. "For David is not ascended into the heavens, but he saith himself, The Lord said unto my Lord." Now you see how that capital L, the first Lord is in uppercase? That is Jehovah, God the Father, said to my Lord, that's God the Son, "Sit thou on my right hand until I make thy foes thy footstool." And that's the key. That's Psalm 110, verse 1. Come and sit at my right hand until it's time for you to go back and destroy your enemies. So when he talks about him coming and sitting at the right hand of power, that's a position he's going to be in until it's time for him to come back and in wrath destroy his enemies. Therefore, verse 36, "Let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God hath made this same Jesus, whom you have crucified, both Lord and Christ." He's the judge or he's the Savior. But he can be one or the other for you. But God's demonstrated that by sitting him at his own right hand. Now come with me to the book of Hebrews, because that verse is quoted four times in the book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapter number 1. Hebrews chapter 1. God, who at sundry times and in divers manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds, who being the brightness of his glory and the expressed image of his person, upholdeth all things by the word of his power, when he hath by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high. And I want you to see where he sat, how it's described. He sat down at the right hand of God. He sat down at the right hand of power. Now he says he sat down at the right hand of the majesty of God. Come over to chapter 8. That word majesty is a word that means greatness. The majesty of God is the greatness of God. There's no one greater than him, is the idea. And we'll see that as we go through this. That means something very special in this context. Hebrews chapter 8, verse 1. Now of the things which we have spoken, this is the psalm. We have such an high priest who is set on the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens. Notice, he sat at the right hand of the throne. When you're sitting at the right hand of the majesty of God, the issue is a throne. The issue is governmental authority, governmental power, governmental rights to rule. And you notice in the verse, he's at the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens. It's important to notice where he's at. Now, we don't have time tonight to talk about that, but we will next time. It's important to notice where this throne is. Come on to chapter 12. Chapter 12, verse number 2. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. And I just point out again the issue of the throne. There's an issue of authority, governing, and the throne here. There's an issue of the kingdom. Message that Christ has been preaching through his earthly ministry, that these believers, these circumcision believers are looking forward to, and that throne issue. And notice in verse 2 there, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross. This sitting down is associated with the cross work. You go back to chapter 1, verse 3, Hebrews 1, 3. Who being the brightness of his glory, the expressed image of his person, upholdeth all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down. Now that's why in chapter 10, Hebrews chapter 10, verse number 10, by the which will we are sanctified, that is by the will of God, through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. And it's that once for all concept that you really need to get there, because there's no perpetual giving of a sacrifice. One sacrifice did the work forever. Every priest standeth daily ministering and offering oft times the same sacrifice, which can never take away sin. But this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, one sacrifice did the work forever. What did he do? He sat down on the right hand of God. Why? Because the work of redemption was done. Didn't need to do it anymore. But look at the next verse. Henceforth, expecting till his enemies be made his footstool. He sat down at the right hand of the throne of the majesty on high because the redemption work was done. But he sits there expecting until he's going to come back and destroy his enemies. So he's not going to sit there forever. The sitting down is done with a view to the second advent of his coming in wrath, or the day of wrath, the day of the Lord's wrath. So he's there sitting at the right hand of the majesty on high, and he's sitting there expecting till his enemies would be made his footstool. So what's happening when he He's crucified. You have the earthly ministry of Christ, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. He dies, he's crucified, then he's resurrected, and then he, after 40 days, he ascends up into heaven, into the heavens, and he sits down at the right hand of the majesty on high in the heavens. And he does that, and he's going to be there until the time for him to come back down to the earth and destroy his enemies and then set up his kingdom on planet earth. So it's the next step in the process, the prophetic process of the kingdom program. You've got the next phase of the kingdom program taking place. In Luke chapter 19, he tells his disciples, man's going to go away, receive a kingdom, and return. In the meantime, he leaves his service down here, and he says, occupy, go out and do the things I've told you to do until I return. So the whole scheme of the prophetic program is being carried out. Now, let's talk a little bit about that issue about the majesty, the throne of the majesty on high, the powers of the heavens. That's talking about, and in Hebrews 1, he says he's the heir of all things. Christ is going to inherit all these things over here based upon what's going on here. Come back with me, if you will, to 1 Chronicles chapter 29. The idea of the majesty of God. 1 Chronicles chapter 29. David over here is giving thanks. 1 Chronicles 29, verse 10. Wherefore David blessed the Lord before all the congregation. And David said, blessed be thou, Lord God of Israel, our Father, forever and ever. Thine, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty. For all that is in the heaven and in the earth is thine. Thine is the kingdom, O Lord. Thou art exalted as head above all. That's the majesty of God. He's exalted as the head, the head ruler, the Lord Most High, the magnificent one, the majesty of God, the throne. He's the one who has all the rights to rule everything there is to rule. Come with me over to the book of Job. And if you just go through your Bible and look at the issues of God's majesty, his greatness, it has to do with him being the ruler. Jeremiah 37. What did I say? Jeremiah? Job. Job 37, verse 22. Fair weather cometh out of the north. With God is terrible majesty. Touching the Almighty, we cannot find him out. He has this tremendous greatness that's beyond our ability to actually comprehend. The rule, the greatness, the glory, the power that's his. Come with me, if you will, to 1 Peter. Peter was witness, an eyewitness to this. It's talking about his kingdom. Make it 2 Peter chapter 1. 2 Peter chapter number 1. Verse number 15. Moreover, I will endeavor that you may be able, after my decease, to have these things always in remembrance. For we have not followed cunningly devised fables. We haven't lied to you, made stuff up. When we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but were eyewitnesses of his majesty. Now this is talking about, for he received from God the Father honor and glory when there came such a voice to him from the excellent glory, this is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. This took place on the Mount of Transfiguration, if you recall that event. And they literally saw, they were eyewitnesses of his majesty. Well, what did he get? He received from God the Father honor and glory. He was declared to be the Son of God, the Messiah, the rightful King. And they literally were eyewitnesses. My what I'm trying to do is connect the throne of his majesty. He sits at the right hand of the throne of his majesty. We're talking about him being the king, the Messiah. We're not just talking about how big and great and wonderful he is. We're talking about a specific role that he has, a specific relationship that he has to his universe. And he's going to be the rightful ruler, the rightful king, the one that is the one in whom all majesty, all greatness resides. Now, look at, you got 2 Peter, look at the book of Jude. Just one more verse. Jude's right before the book of the Revelation. Jude verse 25. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, watch, dominion and power, both now and ever. Amen. So the majesty, the glory that we're talking about here, sitting at the right hand of the majesty on high, we're talking about a governmental structure that he's going to be the head of. Now, that's what I want you to kind of get a grip on. Come with me back to the book of Psalms, if you will, chapter 82. Because when he goes to be the head of the majesty on high, there's this magisterium. That's a great word in religion. They take that word and apply it to the leaders of the church, a hierarchical system. And when you get that, you get the idea that there's this group of rulers. There's a lot of discussion the last couple of weeks in the political world about people being authoritarians, and you have being ruled by an oligarchy or an autocrat, and these are words that describe people that run things. An oligarchy is something that's run by just a small little group. An autocrat by one dictator kind of thing. And you got one political party saying, "Well, you guys are autocrats." The other political guys saying, "You're a bunch of oligarchs and that kind of stuff," arguing back and forth about how people are perceived as to govern. Well, in the kingdom of God, in the majesty, the throne of God's majesty, there is a group of people, a group of angelic creatures who rule with him. And I don't know how you perceive God's working in his universe, but it's not the idea that God sits on the throne and pulls every string, punches every button like this all by himself. He has a whole cadre of created beings in the spirit world. We call them angels. The Bible calls them angels, but there are different classes of angels. And this whole administrative board, I'll show you a verse in Jeremiah, and he calls it a council. I hate that word council. Every council in human history, in church history, has been bad. But the Bible actually calls it that. And you'll see it here in Psalm 82, where he calls them together. In Psalm chapter 82, God standeth in the congregation of the mighty. He judgeth among the gods. And see, that's gods with a little g. Here's the big G God. You know, we talk about that. He's the creator. He's judging among the little g gods. Here are these angelic creatures that God has sent out to represent him and his creation. And now he's going to call them together in a congregation of the mighty ones. And he's going to call them together to give account for their work in creation, their assignments. If you come with me to Job chapter number 1, this is what's going on over in the book of Job. People often are curious or perhaps confounded by the fact that Job chapter 1 verse 6, there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came also among them. In chapter 2, again, there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves. See, they come to present, they come to give account to God of what they've been doing. And Satan came also among them to present himself he's also accountable to the Lord. Now, I used to wonder, how in the world could Satan come before God when God can't do, you know, he's a pure eyes to behold iniquity, can't look at sin. How could God stand Satan in his midst? But that's a different issue. You and I rub shoulders with lost people all the time. It shouldn't surprise you that elect angels and fallen angels can rub shoulders too. You follow that? I was talking to a fellow today, lost guy, and trying to share the gospel with him. I've tried to share it with him time and again. And he's a nice guy, but he's lost, religiously lost, and yet we get along. He's my chiropractor. I have to get along with him. He can crack my bones wrong. But you know, you get along with you rub shoulders with lost people if you go to work and so forth, live in the world. Well, in the angelic realm, there are elect angels, and then there's Satan and his angels. And yet, because of the way things are, the operating system that's there right now, just like the operating system in the earth today, they rub shoulders with one another. And that's what's going on here. The Lord literally calls them together, and Satan is one of the creatures, one of these angelic creatures, who is accountable, and he comes to give account. And the discussion they have there, you notice in chapter 1, verse 6, now there was a day when the sons of God came. Look at chapter 38, Job chapter 38, because that expression, sons of God, that's important. There's this group of, it's called the congregation of the mighty ones. You remember in Isaiah chapter 14 when it talks about Lucifer, who was perfect when day was created till iniquity was found in him. And one of the things he did, he had this plan that produced rebellion. And one of them, he says, I'm going to sit upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. That's what Psalm 82 is talking about. That mount, this place in the universe where God gathers together these decision makers, people who he's assigned responsibility to over various parts of the government of the heavens, and they give account to him. And what Satan's saying, he talks about his throne, Isaiah 14, but then he talks about sitting in the mount of the congregation. I want the angelic world to answer to me instead of to Jehovah. That's part of what his desire was to be the head guy that people answered to. Well, when he talks about the sons of God, Job 37, verse 4, where wast thou when I laid the foundations of the earth? And declare if thou hast understanding, who hath laid the measures thereof, if thou knowest? Or who hath stretched the line upon it? Whereupon are the foundations thereof fastened? And who laid the cornerstone thereof? This is talking about creation. This is talking about the creation in Genesis chapter 1, the 6 days there. And he says in verse number 7, when the morning stars sang together, and the sons of God shouted for joy. Now that's talking about the angelic creation. He calls them the morning stars. Revelation talks about the angels over there being stars. But then he calls them the sons of God. Well, that's a different title. And when I read that, I think there's literally two different statuses of angelic creatures there. And when I say angels, you know, they're seraphim, they're cherubim, they're different living creatures and stuff. And some people don't like to lump them all in angels. The word angel, people tell you, means messenger. And so forth. And if you don't like calling them angels, you want to call them, you know, cherubim and seraphim and whatever else, it's okay with me. I don't mind people doing that. I just don't have a real good other word to describe these literal, real beings in the spirit world. They're not made out of carbon-14 based kind of stuff like we are. But they're real. They're as real as you are. They're as intelligent. They're active. They have all kind of functions and jobs. They're just not in our dimension. Colossians 1, he says, he made all things in heaven and earth visible and invisible. These are the creatures, living creatures in the spirit world. And I, to me, just the easiest word that most people understand, we're talking about different races and categories of angels. But notice, some of them are called stars, and some of them are called the sons of God. That term, sons of God, in the Bible is a very specialized term. Luke chapter 3, Adam is called a son of God. He's a direct creation from God. But there's more to it than just to being a son than just being a creation of God. A son is an adult in the family. He's created for the purpose to work with the Father, to understand what the Father's doing, and to work with Him, and not just to work with Him, but to buy into it, to delight in what the Father's doing. You want your son not just to obey you because you told him to do it. You want him to do what you're doing because he chooses to do it. He buys into it. He's an adult. He understands what you're doing. He understands what the business is. He understands the goal. And he buys into it, and then he makes his own contribution to it and makes it better than you'd have ever made it. Israel, Exodus 4, 22, out of Egypt, if I call my firstborn son. God desired to have a nation in the earth that understood what he was doing, understood what they were created for, and delighted in his will. You and I are called sons. Romans chapter 8, if you're led by the Spirit, you're the sons of God. You're an adult in the family. You know what's going on. You're following what God's doing. So being a son is more than just being in the family. You can be a child. I love that verse in Ephesians 1. It says he's predestinated us to the adoption of children. God wants his children to become adults. Adoption is adulthood. You remember Galatians 4, Paul said that a child will be an heir of all things. It differs nothing from a servant until the time appointed of the father, when the father announces he's an adult now. And that's in Scripture, that's adoption. That's you have your bar mitzvah. You're declared by the Father. You understand what's going on. You've bought into it, and now you're an adult, and you can function in the family's business, just like the Father can. So, there are angels who are in the status of being responsible to make choices on the basis of sonship. By the way, Lucifer in Isaiah 14 is called the son of the morning. He was designed to be an administrator in the government of God. So what God desires is to have participants with him in his creation who know what creation's about, know what he's doing, understand what he's doing, and then participate in it and are a part of what he's accomplishing. And that's, if you go to Psalm chapter 82, that's who these dudes are. God standeth in the congregation of the mighty, and he judgeth among the gods. Verse number 6. And verse 2 to 5 is what he says. And they weren't, the problem with these guys is they aren't functioning the way God designed them to function. They're rebelling. Verse 5, it says, they know not, neither will they understand. They walk in darkness. All the foundations of the earth are out of course. They're not administering justice the way God wants them to. Verse 2, how long will ye judge unjustly? So rather than administering God's will, they're off in rebellion. So verse 6, it says, I have said, ye are gods. And all of you are children of the Most High. Now, again, that term, Most High, the possessor of heaven and earth. That's the term. That's the description of God as the one who possesses all authority to rule in the heaven and the earth. Set up a structure in the universe to do that. He rules it from the throne of his majesty. But they're not sons. They're children. They're not functioning as sons. But ye shall die like men, and fall like one of the princes. Arise, O God, judge the earth, for thou shalt inherit all nations. That's the second advent. That's the whole goal of the issue of creating the nation Israel, was that he could rescue the nations who'd been assigned to these fallen gods. But I just want you to see that this, not so much what they're doing, is there's this structure that he has, in order to take care of and occupy the government in the heavens. Come with me, if you will, to Colossians chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1. When Paul talks about this, and like I said, we'll talk a little bit more about this next time, but get Colossians chapter 1, if you will, and Jeremiah chapter 23. I don't want to forget this verse. Jeremiah 23. Colossians chapter 1, verse 16. For by him were all things created, that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions, principalities or powers. All things were created by him and for him. The things he's talking about, that he's not talking about, you know, the birds and the bunnies and that kind of stuff. He's talking about things in heaven and earth, and he says thrones, dominions, principalities, and powers. So what he's talking about Christ creating here is not just the physical universe, but a governmental structure to operate in that universe. In the earth, you can see it. But there's one in the heavens. That's these spirit beings, angels, if you will. Jeremiah 23. Just one verse. Jeremiah chapter 23, verse number 18. For who hath stood in the counsel of the Lord, and hath perceived and heard his word? Who hath marked his word and heard it? Now notice there are people that are standing in the counsel of the Lord. That is, in what he's counseling them. There's a group of people who he is counseling, who he is advising, he's instructing about how to do things. That isn't just a part of what the nation Israel does. This congregation that we're talking about in the angelic world, he also counsels them. He has this group of sons of God that he gathers together, and he gives them instructions about what he wants done in his universe, and then he invites them to participate with him in the carrying it out. Come with me to the book of Daniel, chapter 4. There's this, and I don't know how to describe it other than to say it's like an administrative board or council who are designed and set up to administer God's creation. Now, he could go and say, pull everything. You know, you have this idea in Calvinistic theology that everything is happening, God's out here pulling the strings, pushing the buttons. But when you come to the Bible, it isn't that God's just doing everything. It's he has a purpose, he has a will, and then he has a creation whom he has given the invitation to come and to freely, intelligently, willingly participate with him in accomplishing it. So what he's doing is he's got this group of people that he's training to think like he thinks, and then sending them out to do what he would do in various situations. It isn't limiting what God's doing. It's expanding what he's doing. In Daniel chapter 4, there's this situation here with Nebuchadnezzar. He's made him the king of all the earth. And Nebuchadnezzar, it's all gone to his head. And he thinks it's all him. So the Lord tells him, verse number 4, and I, Nebuchadnezzar, was at rest in mine house and flourishing in my palace. Daniel 4, verse 5. I saw a dream which made me afraid, and the thoughts upon my bed and the visions of my head troubled me. Therefore made I a decree to bring in all the wise men of Babylon before me, that they might make known unto me the interpretation of the dream. And, of course, they couldn't do it, so he calls Daniel, verse number 8. But at last Daniel came in before me, whose name was Belshazzar, according to the name of my God, and in whom is the spirit of the holy gods. And before him I told the dream. Notice he knows there are a bunch of gods out there. And Belshazzar, master of the magicians, because I know that the spirit of the holy gods is in thee, and no secret troubleth thee, tell me the vision of my dream that I have seen, and the interpretation thereof. Thus were the visions of mine head in my bed. I saw, and behold, a tree in the midst of the earth, and the height thereof was great. The tree grew and was strong, and the height thereof reached unto heaven, and the sight thereof to the end of the earth. And the leaves thereof were fair, and the fruit thereof much, and it was meat for all. And the beasts of the field had shadow under it, and the fowls of heaven dwelt in the boughs thereof, and all flesh was fed of it. And I saw in the visions of my head upon my bed, and behold, a watcher and an holy one came down from heaven. So what he's going to see is, here comes, he calls it a watcher. One of these gods comes down from heaven. And he cried aloud and said thus, hew down the tree and cut off his branches, shake off his leaves, and scatter his fruit. Let the beasts get away from under it, and the fowls from his branches. Nevertheless, leave the stump of his roots in the earth, even with a band of iron and brass, in the tender grass of the field, and let it be wet with the dew of heaven, and let his portion be with the beast in the grass of the earth. Let his heart be changed from man's, and let a beast heart be given unto him, and let seven times pass over him. This matter was by the decree of the watchers and the demand by the word of the holy ones, to the intent that the living may know that the Most High ruleth in the kingdom of men, and giveth it to whomsoever he will, and setteth up over it the basest of men. This is the dream I, King Nebuchadnezzar, had seen. Now thou, O Belshazzar, declare the interpretation thereof. For as much as all the wise men of my kingdom are not able to make known unto me the interpretation, but thou art able, for the spirit of the holy gods is in thee. The thing to notice, particularly, is verse 17. What's going to happen to Belshazzar is by the decree of the watchers and the demand of the words of the holy. In other words, the watchers, these angelic creatures who are watching over the kingdom of Babylon, see what Nebuchadnezzar does. See Nebuchadnezzar decide, I'm the big cheese, I'm doing all this, in order that the world would know that the Most High ruleth in the kingdom of men and gives it to whomever he will. It isn't Nebuchadnezzar. God gave him that position. The watchers have decreed and decided and determined that we need to do something to Nebuchadnezzar in order to do what God wants done. So they make a plan. The plan that they decree, the thing that they desire to happen to Nebuchadnezzar, he goes out for 7 years. He's like an animal. You remember the story? He's like an animal. His, you know, hair grows on him. His fingernails grow like bird claws, and he just becomes a maniac. And in modern medicine, they would call it the disease of lycanthropy, something like that. And he has that happen to him. Daniel tells it, verse 19, 20, 21. Verse 22, it is thou, O king, that art grown. Verse 23, and whereas the king saw a watcher and a holy one coming down from heaven and saying, hew down the tree, and so forth, the watchers declared this. And it's very clear that Daniel tells him, the watchers decided this is what ought to happen to you in order that what God says, what God's will is, would be accomplished. So God, they know what the will of God is. But then they make some choices about how to apply that will into the life of Nebuchadnezzar. Verse 24. This is the interpretation, O king. This is the decree of who? The Most High. Well, verse 17 says it's the decree of the watchers. Verse 24, Dan says, this is the decree of the Most High. What the watchers are doing is applying and executing the will of the one who is the Most High God, possessor of all authority in heaven and earth. The Most High God, Israel has fallen, fifth course of judgment. God raised up Nebuchadnezzar and said, the first time any Gentile nation ever had authority over the whole planet was him. The vision in chapter 2, thou art the head of gold. And God set him up that way. When he went out and thought he did it, God wanted all the nations to know, it's not him. He's doing it because I gave it position. So the watchers, they know what the will of God is. They devise a plan, as it were, to accomplish that. And next time I'll go through some other passages like that. But it's as though you've got this council, advisory council, in the heavens, and the majesty. Come with me to Revelation chapter 4. I'll show them to you in another place. People have the idea, and you have to understand, when Paul writes what he does in Colossians and Ephesians and so forth, Paul is thinking like an Old Testament scholar. Paul was a Jewish rabbi. He would have understood the book of Daniel. He would have understood the book of Chronicles. He thought about God and how the universe worked the way the Old Testament Jew, he had that worldview. So when he says he created these things in heaven and earth, visible and invisible, thrones, dominions, powers, and so forth, when he said that and talks about Jesus Christ sitting as the head of all principality and power, he's thinking about these guys. And he understood that those positions were organized in such a way as to be occupied by creatures in the spirit world who are working with the Most High to accomplish His will. God would state His will, and then they would be given the privilege of applying that will and being trained by God to know how to do it. In Revelation chapter 4, after this I looked and beheld a door was open in heaven. And the first voice which I heard, as it were, a trumpet talking with me, which said, come up hither, and I will show thee things which must be hereafter. And immediately I was in the Spirit, and behold, a throne was set in heaven. Here's the throne of the Majesty on high. And one sat on the throne. And he that sat was to look upon like a jasper and a sardine stone. And there was a rainbow round about the throne in sight like unto an emerald. And round about the throne were 24 seats. And upon the seats I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white raiment. And they had on their head crowns of gold. I mean, here's 24. An elder is a leader. You know, we have elders in the church. 1 Timothy chapter 5, chapter 3, and so forth. The leaders in the church are called elders. And what are leaders? These are people who make decisions about carrying forth the ministry. These 24 elder people argue about who they are. I'm more interested in what they do. They are administrative assistants carrying out God's will in his creation. And out of the throne proceeded, verse 5, lightnings and thunderings and voices. And there were 7 lamps of fire burning about the throne, which are the 7 spirits of God. And before the throne there was a sea of glass like unto crystal. And in the midst of the throne, round about the throne, were 4 beasts full of eyes before and behind. And the first beast was like a lion, the second like a calf, and the third beast had the face of a man. The fourth beast was like a flying eagle. And the four beasts, each had each of them six wings whereby about him, and they were full of eyes within, and they rest not day and night, saying, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God Almighty, which was and which is and which is to come." And when those beasts give glory and honor and thanks to him that sat on the throne, who liveth forever and ever, and the 24 elders fall down before him that sat on the throne and worshiped him that liveth forever and ever, and cast their crowns before the throne, saying, "Worthy, O Lord, to receive, thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created." That's exactly what Colossians 1, 16 and 17 says. And these elders have the crowns. They have authority to operate in God's creation, and yet they're not doing it independent. They're his servants. And they say, "They're yours, and we're just here to do your will." Well, the next chapter, "And I saw on the right hand of him that sat on the throne a book written within and on the backside, sealed with seven seals. And I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, 'Who is worthy to open the book and to loose the seals thereof?'" Here you are in heaven in the throne room of God. You got a book, and the Father's looking for somebody worthy to open the book. So he asks everybody, "Does anybody here know who's worthy?" Now think about that. He could just say, "Only Jesus is worthy," but he didn't do that. He's teaching. "And no man in heaven or in earth, neither under the earth, was able to open the book, neither to look thereon. And I wept much because no man was found worthy to open and read the book, neither to look thereon. And one of the elders said unto me, 'Weeping, weep not. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, hath prevailed to open the book and to loose the seven seals thereof.' And I beheld, and lo, in the midst of the throne and of the four beasts, and in the midst of the elders, stood a lamb as it had been slain, having seven heads and seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent forth into all the earth. And he came and took the book out of the right hand of him that sat upon the throne, and he opened it." But notice, they went looking for the guy. And I think, wow, are you worthy? Are you worthy? You worthy? You worthy? Who's worthy? Anybody? Let's find the one that's worthy. They participated. The Father is teaching them how to do his will, how to find the worthy one. And my point to you is that there's this angelic host who work with the Father, who are invited to participate with him in carrying out his will. That's governmental structure in the heavens is designed to execute, to carry out the will of God. That's what sonship is about. That's what the sons of God were for, to make those choices. Now, you can make that natural understanding, the leap of that for you and me. We learn God's word, will in his word. We have his decree. But then we go out and say, "Thus saith the Lord." And he gives you and me the responsibility to go out into our life and then to apply his word to the details of our life. You have the freedom, and you've been equipped by his word to be able to figure out how to take his word and apply it by faith to the details of your life. That's what maturity is about. That's what growing is about. God has always desired in his creation to have intelligent, informed, free, willing servants to take the truth and apply it in life. He did that with Adam, put Adam in the garden, and he said, "You're to keep the garden, tend to it, God didn't tell Adam everything to do. You know, the old story about Adam and Eve, the first day Adam gets up, the second day they're there, gets up in the morning and he says, well, I guess I'll go out and tend the garden today. And he goes out, he comes back in at lunchtime, he says, well, sugar, what's for lunch? She said, well, maybe we should go ask God. He said, well, he didn't leave it. He didn't say what we're supposed to eat for lunch. Well, maybe you should go ask him. What am I supposed to do in the meantime? Well, you figure it. So you know what she did? She just went out and pulled some tomatoes off of a vine and got some cabbage and some rutabagas and made a stew, made a salad. He didn't tell them every detail. He said, there's this finished creation. Go enjoy it. And there's an entrepreneurial, you know what an entrepreneur is? Somebody that takes something, makes something bigger out of it, creates wealth, value. And that was the mandate, to go out and subdue creation, to have dominion over it, to rule over it. The idea was that God says, here's this wonderful creation. And I've used the illustration many times with you in Ephesians. He says that we might show forth the exceeding greatness of his riches. You do this, next age, it exceeds it. And I can imagine Adam comes home that evening, and Eve has made, you like peaches? Got peaches? Peaches are good. Adam said, oh, that was so wonderful, that sweet, nice, juicy peach. The next day she says, well, you know, he would have liked that, but you know, I bet if I put a little cream on those peaches, it'd be better. You ever had peaches with cream on it? That's better. Next day says, you know, I bet if I just met a cobbler, he'd go, woo-hoo-hoo. And if you ever had peach cobbler, you start with a peach, then you make something a little better, You're using the creative genius to find the wisdom, knowledge, and understanding that God put in creation. The wisdom, knowledge, and understanding that that is in Jesus Christ, that he then created, put in creation. In him are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. We'll talk more about that next time. I just want you to get the idea now is that when he sits up here, there is this whole congregation of sons of God that then have, Daniel calls it, thousands and tens of thousands of angels that are out doing the work. But God isn't pulling strings and pushing buttons. He's teaching them how to think like he thinks and then choosing to go participate in it. Because the Creator isn't interested in having much robots. He's got a whole system whereby he's showing and demonstrating the value that's in his Son, and him all has all preeminence. And then inviting us to participate, inviting all of creation to value and participate in it. So when Jesus Christ goes and sits at the right hand of the Majesty on high, he was going there in order to be the king of a whole creation. And we'll talk more about it next time, okay? All right. I know that's kind of a, whoa. But it's important that you understand that this stuff is real, and it's the way God operates his universe, and you and I in Christ have been invited to participate in the way he's operating it in the dispensation of grace. It's an exciting thing when you can understand it. All right? Father, we thank you tonight for your love and your grace. We thank you for your goodness to us in Christ. We thank you for the way you value freedom, the way you cherish your Son, and the confidence you have that if we could just see in him what you see in him, we'd love him and serve him the way you love him and are served by him. We thank you in Christ's name. Amen. All right.